And I find it fascinating that all the information to form an entire organism exists within the single cell. What is this cell, and where does it come about from? This single cell is the zygote, which is formed by the fertilization of an egg by the sperm. This single cell structure then divides into two cells, then four, then eight, and then 16, and ultimately gives rise to a ball of cells, which is called the blastocyst. This is one of the most important stages of early mammalian development. The outer layer of cells of the blastocyst go on to form extraembryonic tissues, such as the placenta, which help the embryo to attach to the mother and derive support and nutrition. The cells which are in the middle of the embryo are called the inner cell mast cells. And these cells, this handful of cells, gives rise to an entire organism, in other words, to you and to me. It is even more exciting that scientists can remove this handful of cells from within an embryo, put them in a dish, grow them in an incubator, and such cells are called embryonic stem cells. So what is so special about these cells? These cells can do two things. One, they can give rise to more stem cells just like themselves. And secondly, they can give rise to all the cell types that exist within your body. Why is this important? Imagine a situation where a person is suffering from a disorder where a particular type of cell in their body is not functioning or is dysfunctional. One can potentially take embryonic stem cells and differentiate them or convert them into a specialized type of cell and put them back into the patient with the hope of curing such a disorder. As you might well imagine, hundreds of scientists across the world are interested in understanding what makes a stem cell different from a specialized cell. In my laboratory too, at the National Center for Cell Science in Pune, we are interested in asking this question. We are specifically interested in asking how molecules get into cells and whether the way they enter the cell is what makes a stem cell different. A number of molecules are present on the surface of cells, and these enter cells through specific routes or points of entry. Once a molecule enters a cell, it provides a signal for the cell to either perform a specific function or to behave in a certain manner. What we want to know is whether stem cells take up different molecules and whether the mode of entry of these molecules is different and whether this contributes to making a stem cell special and different from any other type of cell. I'm now going to tell you about another type of stem cell which is present in our body. And these are called adult stem cells. Unlike embryonic stem cells, these are not present in the embryo, but are present in every single organ and organ system that is there in our body. For example, the liver has a small percentage of cells called liver stem cells, whose only job is to maintain and repair the liver throughout the lifetime of the individual. And this is not just for the liver, it's for every other organ in your body. Your blood system, bone marrow, your nervous system, your skin, and so on and so forth. So these cells are set aside right at the very beginning to help to repair and to maintain these cells throughout an individual's lifetime. So what I've told you so far is about two types of stem cells, embryonic stem cells and adult stem cells. And while both of them can clearly do fantastic things, there are certain drawbacks which are associated with both these types of cells. Embryonic stem cells, because they are derived from the embryo, it means that one must either destroy or damage an embryo in order to get these cells. So there are obvious ethical implications which come with this. Additionally, if one were to use embryonic stem cell-derived cells as a means for cell transplantation, it is not always that you're going to get a perfect match between the donor and the recipient who's about to receive the cells. And this could result in clinical and medical complications. Adult stem cells, as I mentioned, are present in specific organs. They are cells which are present in each organ. And they are good at only producing those cells which are present in that organ. You cannot expect a liver stem cell, for instance, to start producing neurons all of a sudden. It just won't work. So what would be perfect in the field of stem cells and for stem cell-based therapies is if we could get a stem cell which had the properties of an embryonic stem cell. In other words, a cell which could produce every cell type in the body, but without the ethical complications, and a stem cell which was specific for each one of us, so that we would not have to worry about a mismatch between a donor and a recipient. The solution to this was arrived at in 2007 by work done in Shinya Yamanaka's lab in Japan, where they took specialized cells and introduced certain specific DNA elements into these cells. These cells went on to give rise to embryonic stem cell-like cells, and this won them the Nobel in 2012. These cells were called induced pluripotent stem cells. What is so special about these cells? These cells are very similar to embryonic stem cells in that they can give rise to more cells just like themselves. And they can also give rise to every single cell type which is present in the body. The beauty about induced pluripotent stem cells is that we can make these cells for each and every one of us sitting in this room by taking just a few skin cells and introducing certain DNA elements into these cells. And hence, we have our own individual bank of induced pluripotent stem cells for each of us. What can we do with these cells? One can potentially use these cells to cure almost any type of disorder which affects people. And this can be done by taking induced pluripotent stem cells and differentiating them into the specific type of cell which is affected in people with certain disorders. These disorders can range from anything like muscular dystrophy, neurodegenerative disorders, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, diabetes, stroke. The list can go on and on forever. In addition to cell-based therapies, induced pluripotent stem cells can also be used for drug testing. What is well appreciated in literature is that no two individuals respond to a particular medication in an identical manner. For instance, a particular drug might work very well for one person and may not work at all for another, or may have adverse effects. Using induced pluripotent stem cells from the individual that you would like to test, you can plate these cells in a dish and add whatever combination or concentration of drug that you would like to test and determine the most effective drug regimen that can be administered to the patient in order to get an effective output. Induced pluripotent stem cells can also be combined with gene editing to achieve very powerful ends. In recent years, a system which was discovered in bacteria for gene editing called the CRISPR-Cas9 system can be coupled with induced pluripotent stem cells to cure certain disorders which arise due to mutations or mistakes in the DNA sequence. How can this be done? Certain disorders arise because the DNA sequence in that individual has a mistake, because of which either a misfolded or a mistaken protein is produced in these people, which cannot carry out its perfect function. Using gene editing tools, one can very accurately just cut out that portion of the damaged DNA and replace it with the correct portion of DNA. If this is done in induced pluripotent stem cells, these cells can then be converted into specialized cells, which can potentially be transplanted back into the individual. And now the person should have functional cells and could be cured of the disorder. Now, while all this sounds very fantastic, and it is obvious that stem cells are truly the future of regenerative medicine and personalized medicine, one has to remember that it is only a handful of stem cell-based therapies that are approved and proven by regulatory agencies, both in India as well as elsewhere in the world. It is important to only take those therapies which have crossed these regulatory procedures into the clinic, because there may be terrible adverse effects of unproven and unsafe therapies. What do I mean by this? I would like to bring up a case of a child who was suffering from a neurodegenerative disorder. This child was given two rounds of transplantation of neural stem cells from two completely unrelated individuals. A few months after receiving these transplants, this child developed tumors in the brain and all along the spinal cord. What this therapy is an example of one such unproven and untested therapy. It is important to understand that while stem cells are truly the future of medicine, they are the only cells which have the potential to cure almost any cell-based disorder. One has to remember that science has to progress at its own pace, and we have to give doctors, scientists, and researchers both the time, the funding, and the space to allow us to explore all the benefits of stem cell research before pushing them into the clinic. One has to remember that unlike a pill, if it has side effects, you can stop it tomorrow and move on to another medicine. If you were to introduce a specific cell type or a stem cell-derived cell in your body, there is no way you can get rid of it. So it is better to be safe rather than to face any type of adverse effect. In conclusion, I would like to say that stem cells truly present the future of medicine. They are going to help mankind, but we have to remember that we need to wait in order to make sure that stem cell-based therapies are indeed safe and effective before pushing them into the clinic. Thank you.